So I remember the first time I learned about cancer. I was about 10 years old, and I was on a family trip visiting relatives in Vancouver, Canada. One night after dinner, some of us went into the living room to play cards. And we're all having a great time, laughing, shouting, when I thought I heard something in the background. No one else seemed to notice, so I turned to one of my aunts and asked, "Did you hear that?" And then we all became quiet. And then we all heard the unmistakable sound of someone throwing up. And that someone was my grandmother. I later learned that my grandmother had colorectal cancer, and she was throwing up because of the chemotherapy that she was taking. Colorectal cancer would take my grandmother's life. My story is in no way unique, and most, if not everyone, listening today has been impacted by cancer. Despite decreasing cancer death rates in the United States, the reality is approximately 600,000 people will die of cancer in the United States this year. 600,000. That's about the same number of people in the city of Portland gone every year because of cancer. So what are we doing about this? Well, I believe the key to eradicating cancer is within each and every one of us. It's your immune system. In fact, if there's only one thing that you remember from my talk today, I hope it's this. Without doubt, the immune system is capable of curing advanced cancer. The problem, however, is that the immune system can't cure some patients because cancer can find ways to evade the immune response. But what if we could help the immune system, engineer it in a way that makes it better attack cancer? Well, we actually can, and today I'm going to describe how we're doing it. But first, what is your immune system? It's simply parts of your body that are involved with keeping you safe from things like bacteria and viruses. You've probably heard of some of these components: tonsils, spleen, lymph nodes, white blood cells. And while there are many different types of white blood cells, today I'd like to focus on one particular type of white blood cell called the T cell. And so within each and every one of us, we have billions upon billions of T cells patrolling, keeping us safe. And most of these T cells are not the same because they express a unique receptor protruding from the cell surface called a T cell receptor. Each T cell receptor can recognize something different, which allows the billions of T cells in your body to respond to virtually any microscopic invader that enters your body. For example, let's say you're infected with the flu. Flu virus infects one of your cells. There will be a small number of T cells in your body, the ones with the right T cell receptor, that will be able to recognize and eliminate the virus-infected cells. But what does this have to do with cancer? Well, it turns out that in patients with cancer, they too have T cells, the ones with the right T cell receptor that can actually recognize and target their own cancer. But the fact that the cancers continue to grow means that these T cells are losing the battle. So how might we help these T cells out? Well, one approach to help these T cells was developed by a pioneer in the cancer immunotherapy field, Dr. Steve Rosenberg, and it's called adoptive cell therapy. In the first generation of adoptive cell therapy, a tumor is removed from a patient. Then the T cells within the tumor are amplified, expanded to large numbers, typically in the billions. And then these T cells are reinfused back into the patient. And so the premise behind this approach is actually quite simple. It's that some of the T cells within the tumor are there because they're recognizing the cancer. But again, they're losing the battle. But if you can somehow amplify, generate a large army of these tumor-reactive T cells, then perhaps this army can then overwhelm and destroy the cancer. Did this therapy work? This therapy was tested most extensively in patients with metastatic melanoma, which is the deadliest form of skin cancer. I'd like to show you one example of what this therapy can do. So here's a patient, young patient, with this bulky melanoma on the shoulder and neck area had spread to lymph nodes. Dr. Rosenberg's team grew out the T cells within one of his tumors, amplified them to the billions, and then infused them back into the patient. As seen in this image here, just 12 days later, you can see that the melanomas have essentially melted away. And so they tested. And so after testing this therapy in hundreds of patients with metastatic melanoma, a few lessons were learned. The first lesson was that adoptive cell therapy could cure some patients with metastatic melanoma, could lead to the complete destruction, eradication of all traces of cancer in some patients. This demonstrated that T cells could be powerful weapons against cancer. The second lesson learned was that T cells targeting cancer mutations likely mediated the curative responses. Some of you may know this, but a cancer cell is different than a normal cell because it's got changes or mistakes in the DNA and protein sequences. These mistakes are called mutations. And maybe you're not surprised now, but in patients with cancer, there are T cells, the ones with the right T cell receptor, that can actually target the unique mutations expressed by their own cancer. So while melanoma is deadly, it's actually relatively rare. The majority of cancer-related deaths are due to cancers that we've all heard of. Difficult-to-treat cancers, colon cancer, breast cancer, lung cancer, liver cancer, pancreatic cancer, bile duct cancer, head and neck cancers, and others. So, could we harness mutation-reactive T cells to treat these difficult-to-treat cancers? I'd like to highlight one patient during my training with Dr. Rosenberg at the NIH that begins to answer this question. The patient's name is Melinda Bikini. She is 41, a mother of six, when she was diagnosed with widely metastatic cholangiocarcinoma, which is also known as bile duct cancer. She had surgery, multiple lines of chemotherapy. But as you can see from these scans, the bile duct cancer had spread and invaded into her lungs. You can see these bulky masses of bile duct cancer in her lungs. So we took one of Melinda's tumors into the lab. We grew out the T cells. And in Melinda's case, we were actually able to find T cells that targeted a specific mutation expressed by her cancer. We amplified these T cells, and then we infused over 100 billion of these mutation T cells, reactive T cells, back into her. And then we waited. And I remember being very anxious because this was the first time ever that mutation reactive T cells were being harnessed to treat this sort of cancer. And then her 1 month scans came in and it showed that the tumors were shrinking. And I was relieved, but only for a split second because the scientist in me was wondering how long would this response last for? Fortunately for Melinda, this response was long lasting. As you can see in these scans, 2 years later, you can see that the tumors have substantially shrank and some have actually disappeared. And in fact, here's Melinda with me just a few years ago outside my lab here in Portland, Oregon. And as of today, she remains alive, healthy, and well, almost 9 years after the infusion of those mutation reactive T cells. And while we are excited by these results and happy for Melinda, the harsh reality was that this therapy did not help other patients with these difficult to treat cancers. So we went back to the drawing board. Why was this therapy failing these other patients? Well, it turns out that T cells, like humans, can age. They can become old, exhausted. And it turns out that many of the T cells within the tumor are just that. They're old and tired. Remember, these T cells have been likely in the tumor for a long time, maybe months, maybe even years, fighting the battle in a hostile tumor environment. And they're losing the battle, and they're getting old and exhausted. If that's the case, how would we get around an old, exhausted T cell? Well, what if we could first find a mutation-reactive T cell? It could be old and exhausted. And then isolate that T cell receptor that I was telling you about. And then genetically insert that into younger T cells within peripheral blood of these patients. In essence, performing a T cell receptor transplant. This might sound like science fiction, but this strategy is known as T cell receptor, or TCR, gene therapy, and it's being tested in clinical trials. And my lab at Providence Cancer Institute, right here in Portland, Oregon, was the first in the world to use this therapy to treat patients with pancreatic cancer. And I'd like to highlight one patient, Kathy Wilkes, 71-year-old woman that we treated with TCR gene therapy. So Kathy had metastatic pancreatic cancer. She had surgery, chemotherapy, chemotherapy plus radiation therapy, and another experimental immunotherapy. But as you can see in these scans of her lung, the pancreatic tumors had actually spread to her lungs and were growing. So for Kathy, we took her blood cells, and then into her blood T cells, we genetically inserted a T cell receptor that specifically targeted a mutation expressed by her cancer. And then we amplified these cells in the lab. And then we infused about 15 billion of these gene engineered T cells back into her. And then we waited, anxiously as usual. And then her 1 month scans came in, showed that the tumors were shrinking. But, again, I was relieved for only a short while because a scientist in me was wondering how long this response would last for. As seen in these scans just 6 months later, it shows that the tumors were shrinking, and they'd actually shrank by about 70%. And only while time will tell how long this response will last for, this was actually the first proof of principle that this TCR gene therapy targeting a mutation could cause metastatic pancreatic cancer to shrink. Despite promise, TCR gene therapy has not worked for other patients with pancreatic cancer. And it's a tough pill to swallow to have patients die despite your best efforts. But I'm optimistic. And I'm optimistic because the ability to insert a T-cell receptor into another T-cell to redirect it to target cancer is only the beginning of T-cell gene engineering. In addition to this, we can insert genes into T-cells that protect them from the suppressive effects of tumors. We can insert genes into T-cells that greatly enhance their ability to kill cancer cells. In essence, gene engineering can be used to armor and supercharge T cells so that they have a better chance of eradicating cancer in more patients. So while cancer is formidable, so are we. I believe with innovations in gene engineered cell therapies, it is only a matter of time before we finish cancer.